Hi folks, Squint here, and this is the first in a series of instructional videos, at least for me, as I try to take in the content that others in the fighting game community have put out that I could probably learn something from and get my footing, as opposed to just throwing myself entirely against the fighting games, which I'm doing in my live streams. But this is the flip side of that. This is like the homework of that. So I'm going to be starting off with Core A Gaming. This video is entitled "Analysis: Why Button Mashing Doesn't Work," and apparently it's a pretty good primer on just fighting game mechanics in general, not just button mashing. So this should be good viewing. So without further ado, let's get started. Let's see what it has to tell me.
Button mashing in a first-person shooter doesn't work because you just waste all your ammo before you got anywhere. It doesn't work in real-time strategy because you wouldn't even be able to select your starting units.
Commander, there are tutorial videos.
Makes sense so far.
And mashing in a driving game would probably
Oh, you're
like
a truck simulator too, I have that game.
It's obvious why it doesn't work in those games, because random button mashing is the video game equivalent of violently flailing your limbs. That's why it kind of makes sense that people button mash in fighting games. Most people don't know how to fight in real life. Violent limb flailing might be a good strategy for beating your younger brother
or
sister, but everyone knows that this is far from martial arts mastery. It is understandable why people do this. When you have no choice but to fight, it's better to do something than to just stand there getting hit like a dummy. Game developers understand this, which is why they've taken measures to make button mashing do cool things. Mash punch to punch a lot, mash kick to kick a lot, mash L to do all this.
Wow.
Stuff like this can make limb flailing a bit more dangerous, but it won't make button mashing any more of a viable strategy against people who know.
Dragon Ball FighterZ is, or Fighters, sorry, is one of the games that I'll be exploring as I try to familiarize myself with fighting games. And what I saw there was it looked like you press one button to do a whole lot of stuff, and he was illustrating it by cleaning off a single button and doing all this cool stuff. So curious to see what the skill cap is for a system like that.
What they're doing.
It's a button mashing
fighting
game.
So what are these people doing that mashes are not? Why does button mashing not work against them? To find out, we have to go back to the beginning of a round.
Round one, fight!
In many forms of wrestling, the round starts up close. Sometimes really close. In pistol dueling, which was an actual Olympic exhibition in 1908, the fight started from about 20 meters away. But in video game fighting, you can have a wrestler and a gunwoman in the same fight, allowing players to battle in all sorts of ranges. Guess who has the advantage at this range? And at this range? The fight ideally starts where neither person has a significant advantage, a situation where it's neutral for both fighters. If you're mashing when the round starts, you might get hit like this. Mashing randomly fails to consider which attacks have good reach. The side perspective in these games help you gauge distance so you can clearly see your positioning and attack ranges. Having a longer reach means there are ranges where you can hit them while they can't hit you.
I actually, okay, so the term that he's put forth is neutral, where technically nobody's attacking or defending, but there's approaches where you are like getting or taking distance from your enemy in an attempt to get an advantage. That's what it sounds like to me. So that's kind of like the beginning state of the game. Okay. Neutral.
Why use a stubby jab at this range when you have Engine Blade? Another problem with constantly attacking is that when you start an attacking animation, you cannot block until it finishes. The longer the attack animation, the longer you're vulnerable to getting hit. Whiffing an attack and getting hit before you can block again is called a whiff punish.
Oh my goodness!
Fighting games loosely borrow this logic from real fighting. This whiff, then punish, is called a cross counter. Just like in any fighting sport, attacking carries risk. It's especially dangerous in games with long-range moves that start up quick lead to good damage, and have long recovery animations when whiffing. The hard slash in the Samurai Showdown series is one of the most notorious examples of this. Whiffing it is...
ill-advised.
Another problem with constantly attacking is that you often...
That's probably what my hands look like when I'm playing fighting games. I'm trying to get better, though.
Cannot attack and control your movement at the same time. And movement matters because your positioning determines if an attack will reach or not. While you can't move your head like this in most games, you can move your feet. When you form a strategy based on movement and striking ranges, you have what people like to call footsies.
Oh, footsies. In my very first learning about fighting game stream, I played a game called Footsies, where it was about, yeah, kind of like spacing yourself out and using like a sliding kick to kind of like try and catch the opponent as they were like moving right into range. There were some other moves, but anyway.
The kick I'm doing is the most effective move for both range footsies.
But the movement doesn't necessarily have to be with your feet, because video games have magical characters that can wheel, fly, unfly, or even hover because you happen to be a punching bag. One definition from the Street Fighter-based Footsies Handbook describes footsies as the mid-range ground-based aspect of fighting game strategy. And High Fight has made an entire game around this concept called
there it is.
Footsies.
That's
this
game
is so mid-range and ground-based that there's no jumping, no project.
Okay, so I guess I probably got a pretty good start then, because I played Footsies on my first stream and Dive Kick, which was instructional in a different kind of way. Maybe he'll talk about Dive Kick, I don't know. But yeah, so, all right. I'm already on a few pages that they're talking about.
Tiles and no knockdowns. But what kind of strategy can you have with something so simple? Well, the first lesson of Chapter 1 in the Footsies Handbook shows one of the most basic strategies. Walk into your opponent's striking range and immediately walk right out to bait them into whipping an attack.
I did try to do that, although it was against a CPU, so...
Here it is at normal speed. The strategy is referenced.
I don't really
so
know if you can bait
you see
a
it across so many games.
Down 4-1, down 4-2 is inside, so it's all AK is doing right now, but oh, he can't whip!
There are countless strategies, but their effectiveness will differ from game to game. This might be why it's hard for people to agree on what footsies are, and why it's kind of turned into a buzzword. And this raises the question, if footsies are about movement and striking ranges, can't everything be considered footsies? Sure, but there are times when your amazing reach doesn't matter as much, like when you're up close and personal.
I tried playing against Dalsim in Super Street Fighter 2, and he absolutely destroyed me. So getting in close was a real struggle for me against Dalsim, who I recognize right there.
No matter what anyone says, there is no law that requires you to play footsies. Sometimes you just want to brawl, but you can't just walk up to a skilled fighter without getting hit. That's why most games let you do much more than walk. You can run, roll, dive kick, demon flip, homing teleport, dash, rush attack, or even do a homing dash attack. These things can help you quickly bypass the fighting at further ranges and get right up to your opponent's face. Playing this way is known as rushdown, or the more derogatory, unga bunga.
The hell is unga bunga?
That's right.
When people are hurling their entire bodies at you, it can be pretty dangerous.
I think out of the gate my style is pretty rushed down because so far, like whenever I like kind of slow down and take stock of what I'm doing, I feel like I'm being very aggressive in my play. And I don't know a lot about higher level or skilled competition, but probably the amount of aggression I show would get punished pretty hard. So I try to dial it back and do more of the footsie like wiggle stuff that Corey was talking about earlier. You know, sometimes you get in the moment, you just want to wail on them.
So, how the hell do you stop this insanity? Well, if you're good enough, you can try to hit them before they can get to you. For example, hitting someone out of the air is called an anti-air, but this requires precise timing. Just like swinging in a baseball game, you can't expect to be successful by mashing. Mistime it and get struck out, or in fighting, mistime it and get knocked out. This is one reason the Dragon Punch, aka Sheng Long, is such a good anti-air. Okay. It covers this whole area. But sometimes their rushdown will be too fast for your reactions, which means you might be face to face. Now finally, both of you are close enough to hug. But up close, the fight becomes very different for reasons other than being able to grab each other. There's little room to move forward, and the reach of your attack is less important because any attack will reach. What matters more here is who will grab or strike the other person first, which is determined by attack speed, or more technically, the startup animation. Naturally, the move with the faster startup speed will beat out the slower ones, assuming the buttons are pressed at the same time. A reason why Fox's Shine is considered one of the best moves in Melee is because it starts up in one frame, aka instantly.
That blue light special, man.
And that jab that I called stubby earlier will beat out the engine blade up close because it's much faster. When you hit someone during their attack startup animation like this, it's called a counter hit. And depending on the move or game, the attacker might get rewarded with extra damage, more combo opportunities, or in punch out, an instant knockout.
Yeah, I've tried to, like, when I'm just trying to start hitting an opponent, I try to open, again, I've really only played Street Fighter up until the point where I'm recording this video, but I try to open with a light attack because they're faster and I won't get beat to the punch, literally.
So how do you know which attacks are faster than others and by how much? You could eyeball it, but it gets really hard to tell when we're talking about moves with differences of a few frames. A frame is 1/60th of a second, which is the unit of time used to measure speed in fighting games. But thanks to cool people, there are frame data guides that show you the speed of each attack. Since the one jab is the fastest move Noctis has, you decide to jab up close, but your opponent blocks it. This is where the attacker is stuck in an attacking animation and the blocker is stuck in a blocking state known as block stun. The question is, who will be the first to recover and do a follow-up attack? The answer is Blue Noctis. He gets to attack one frame sooner because his jab made him plus one when it was blocked. I know this because I looked it up. If both Nocti followed up with a jab here, Blue Noctis would beat out Red Noctis by one frame. If a move is zero on block, they both recover at the same time, hitting each other.
Okay.
If a move is minus one on block, the blocker gets unstuck first by one frame and wins the exchange.
Okay, this seems like a lot to keep track of. Like, plus one on block, minus one on block, zero. So it all depends on what attack you're throwing, whether or not it gets blocked, and what attack the opponent's going to give in the... I think I'm still a ways away from being able to process all this. I mean, I understand what he's talking about, but it just seems like a lot of, like, memorization and... I mean, to be really, really optimal in your game.
This is called frame advantage. Each of the thousands of moves out there has an on-block and on-hit value that determine what your best follow-up options are.
Easy peasy lemon squeeze!
The speed of the jab and its plus one on block frame advantage is why multi-evo champ JDCR made an entire video discussing the importance of Tekken's one jab.
초보자분들이 잘 이 게임을 보일 때 잘 못 보는 경우가 뭐냐면은 되게 큰 기술만 많이 봐요. 뭐 넘어뜨리는 기술, 뛰는 기술, 데미지가 센 기술. 근데 실질적인 격투 게임의 과정은 누가 그 기술을 먼저 유효하게 히트시키냐가 관건이거든요. 작은 기술을 써야지 안전하게 큰 기술을 쓸 수 있는 상황을 자기가 만들 수가 있어요. 또 원잽 자체가 실패했을 때도 리스크가 거의 없어요. 보통의 위험한 기술들은 내가 막 허치거나 막히면은 리스크가 커서 이제 반격을 당하지만 원잽은 뭐 프레임도 실질적으로 이득이고 허쳐도 자신이 당하는 후딜이 이제 리커버리가 크지 않기 때문에 많은 역할을 하는 기술을 할 수가 있죠. 이런 이제 초보분들이 잘 못 보는 부분을 이렇게 조금 작은 기술에 좀 포커스를 주시면 좋을 것 같아요.
Okay, so it sounds like I'm probably on the right track with the logic I use to approach what attacks I open with. Like open with the faster you know, they're not as damaging, but they'll give you, I guess, a better chance at a frame advantage, or at least you won't overcommit and okay.
The frame advantage can also help explain why you get hit in certain situations. This is me blocking Law's Dragonhammer move. The Law players watching will know that I shouldn't be mashing buttons here, but I did, and I died. This move is +3 on block, and its follow-up attack has a startup speed of 11 frames. That means I needed a move with a startup speed faster than 8 frames to beat out Law's attack. According to the frame data of my character, that move doesn't exist. This means no matter what attack I mashed, I would have gotten hit by Law's follow-up move.
Okay.
In other words,
it's a trap!
More specifically, a frame trap. Frame traps are one of the top reasons why button mashing doesn't work.
After Asuka's Wild Standing 4, on hit, you cannot sidestep. You cannot press a single button, otherwise down 2 will counter-hit launch you. It's something that Fergus likes to call the scrub killer.
While being plus is great, being minus can be really bad. If your attack on block has enough minus frames, your opponent will have enough time to punish you before you can recover. But sometimes, even if you have enough time to punish, you might not reach. The pushback in Super Street Fighter 2 Turbo is huge. One block sweep can send you back to footsie's range, and one extra fireball can take you to the end of the screen. ST Ryu says a lull to your nerdy frame data while zoning you out with fireballs. At this range, your punches and kicks won't reach, and if you don't have a projectile to fight back with, you have to dodge and close in. Mashing here will be as if...
I did have some success in this exact matchup, actually, as Ryu against Zangief. It felt cheesy, but I was able to win by fireballing him out. And but, you know, I'm still new, so I'm having trouble being consistent with the input, so a lot of times I wouldn't do the fireball when I wanted to, and he would close in and then grab me and do a whole bunch of damage. So, yeah.
Effective as mashing here.
Nice.
These are situations where the striking ranges of punches and kicks are less emphasized, but there are also moments when movement is less emphasized, like when you can't move.
Knockdowns.
If your footsies, ungamentals, or fireball game are godlike, you might score a knockdown on your opponent. The downed player is at a disadvantage because they cannot move or attack, while the standing player can do whatever they want. This is where the honorable player will step back and let their opponent get up and take a breather, right? Of course not. This is where you make their life hell. While your opponent is down, you have a chance to move in closer or run away, whichever is best for your character. Depending on your positioning, you might also get a chance to attack your opponent as soon as they get up. The art of attacking your opponent while they're getting up is called Oki Zeme. Oki from the Japanese word to wake up, and Zeme from the word for attack. Like a lot of beat-em-up games, you usually can't hit them while they're on the ground because they're invulnerable, but you can do the next best thing. Time an attack so it hits them the very first moment they're vulnerable. This kind of attack is called meaty, but meaty is a spectrum.
Oh, that was so meaty!
The later in your attack animation you hit your opponent, the meatier it is, okay. And the sooner your animation will recover, giving you extra plus frames. Button mash.
Okay, so as I understood it, meaty is when you intentionally, or like you time your attack so that the part of the point at which the attack can do damage intersects with the exact moment that you can do damage to somebody who's getting up. So that's meaty. Okay. It's a lot to take in. I don't know how often I will get the chance to use the term meaty specifically, if I even recognize it's happening.
Characters tend to eat meaty attacks like a barbecue buffet because they're always pressing buttons while waking up instead of blocking. Okay. So the solution is to just block, right? Often.
So getting back to button mashing.
Sometimes yes, but depending on the type of attack and direction, you have to choose the correct way to block, high or low and left or right. When the attacker makes this ambiguous for you, it's called a mix-up.
I'ma block this whack-ass mix-up.
But what if you don't want to block and you don't want to get hit? There is another option. In addition to being a good anti-air, Shenlong is also one of many different types of invincible reversals. If timed correctly, these moves will be invulnerable at the moment you get up, allowing you to go through the meaty attack and hit them instead.
Okay, so there's... So like rock, paper, scissors, there's even a counter to the meaty. So there's always options, or there's always an optimal course of action. I'm sure the trick is remembering what the optimal course of action is, knowing I have to apply it, and then successfully inputting the commands to make it happen. So yeah, there's a lot going on, even in like superficially, like on the surface seemingly simple situations, like getting up from being knocked down, you know. So your opponent is like doing a mix-up or employing something where you don't exactly know what they're going to do. So you just got to kind of guess at, and hope that you are correctly inputting the counter. Because this is happening in like split second, you know. I feel like a reaction time might be a factor, which is bad news for me because I'm getting older.
So how do you defeat Shenlong and stand a chance? You just move away or block. Ryu was exaggerating about Shenlong the whole time. And of course, to beat block, you grab.
Right corner pressure, power going in. What's next? Another one? Three? Don't tell me four!
As you can see, Okizema is about commitments and decision making because the timing of the exchange...
Yeah, like right there. That's actually, you know, rock, paper, scissors tactic. There's no way that they would throw scissors four times in a row. You know, it's like, well, there's nothing keeping them from doing that. If you keep thinking they're going to switch up throwing scissors and they don't, well, then you lose.
Change revolves around someone getting up. Some games like Tekken let you hit people on the ground and from the ground, but you still have to get up eventually. And sometimes $60,000 can be riding on the one decision you commit to.
$60,000! With one mix-up!
So are these sick reads or lucky guesses?
Doing some shit off of somebody's wig.
I was wondering about that. It's like, can you actually, like, are people actually so good that they can actually process what they have to do in those frames, those 1/60th of a second? Or is some of it just like, you know, hope for the best?
Wake-up is a guess.
This can get pretty political, especially waking up super while American.
Not enough to kill.
Oh, he's got him again!
Three for three!
Such is the nature of Okizema. Some or all of these concepts apply to every fighting game, but each game will have a different take on how they work. And the diversity of characters allow there to be unique playstyles within the game. But the other aspect of what makes these characters interesting is how you play them. One of the most memorable Street Fighter matches was a DreamHack winner 2013. An unknown amateur Ryu who went by the tag Gandhi had such a bit.
This match I learned about a couple months ago, and that's one of the things that like I looked into and it got me interested because it was an interesting story. But he's about to explain it, so I'll just let him.
Bizarre playstyle, he tilted his more orthodox opponent and ended up beating him.
FSP is completely.
He tilted? That's another term I'm gonna hopefully maybe he'll say what tilted means because I don't know.
FSP is completely, I want to say mind effed.
And this match kind of ended up being the Ecce Mono of Street Fighter, a well-intentioned beginner uncompromised by formal training. But while Gandhi was playing at a beginner level, he was far from randomly button mashing. These jabs, even though he was whiffing against a crouching opponent, indicate that he understands quick attacks are preferable at close ranges. Him jumping back and throwing fireballs shows he wants to throw projectiles safely from a distance, and here he even does an anti-air. His rushdown-
I've definitely done the, like, it's almost a habit, even, like, the jump back fireball, it feels safe. It's like, if they block it, fine. They jump over it, well, I can react to that, but yeah, that's actually a habit of mine. I'm sure once I go up against human opponents, they'll punish me for doing that over and over again, so I probably have to knock it off.
Jump attacks are so unpredictable, even he doesn't seem to know when he'll do them, and when he knocks down his opponent, he adds pressure using some basic Okizema, even closing out a round with a meaty jab.
It's not working!
And of course, he uses invincible Dragon Punch reversals on his wake up to stop pressure. A lot.
Jump!
not be doing this. I wouldn't even be. Wait, the team!
Wake up.
Gandhi might not have known how to FADC combo into Ultra like his opponent, but he had a semblance of the basics, and it was enough for him to enter a tournament, win a match, and have a great time doing it. Isn't that what everyone's trying to do, after all? This was Gerald from Corey Gaming. Thanks for watching. If you get a chance, please check out the new merch store. There's some awesome new stuff in there.
All right. Well, thank you, Gerald. I very much enjoyed that video, and yeah, it gave me a lot to process, but it was very informative. It was actually not much fluff at all. It was as the kids might say, meaty. Not a lot of filler, which I like. And yeah, so one of the things that I took away from this is that I'm kind of on the right track. Where like I when I was playing footsies, I was kind of grasping, you know, it's like, okay, we both have the exact same moves and they both have the exact same reach, so I have to stay out of reach and then move in and then try to attack, or move in and then start moving back out and hoping he attacks or he whiffs, to use another term, he whiffs and then I move in. So and then like in dive kick, I have to see when they're jumping, try to anticipate when they're going to try to dive against me so that I jump back, or I jump first and hope they jump second so that I'm above them and then I can kick down on them. So yeah, it's good stuff. It's good stuff. So I'm going to be doing more of these videos. If you have a suggestion for videos that I would probably get some use out of, please let me know. One of the things that one of the terms that I that Footsies had in it was hit confirm, and I wasn't exactly sure what hit confirm meant. Just sometimes when I would knock out the CPU, there would be this big word confirm behind me, and then you look at the stats and it says hit confirm this many times. I was like, well, what does that mean? And so that's something I'd like to know the meaning of, especially if it's in footsies. It must be a pretty fundamental term. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you, Gerald from Corey Gaming, for that wonderful primer. I enjoyed it very much, and see you next time.